Good evening and welcome. My name is Eleanor Wallace. Baryshnikov Art Center commissioned Holland Andrews to create a work for our digital season, which was filmed last November in our John Cage and Merce Cunningham studio. Holland, thank you for your beautiful and meditative Museum of Calm. We look forward to hearing about your creative process and welcome Morgan Bassichis, who will lead the conversation. Thank you all for being here. Museum of Calm is available to watch now on our website until Monday, March 29th. Holland and Morgan, now I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Eleanor.
Hi, Holland.
Hi, Morgan.
This is so exciting. I'm so happy to be here with you.
It's so mutual. You don't even know, even though you do, because that's how things that are mutual work.
Exactly.
Oh, man.
So good to be here, and welcome to everyone who's tuning in.
My name is Carrie Gross.
And I have some very professional questions to ask you about this incredible work that you made, Museum of Calm. And I just first want to just start by thanking you for this work. You know, I mean, you described it as a wordless transmission of all the love that's in your body. And I just, on behalf of all of us receiving this transmission, thank you.
Mm. Absolutely. I was really fascinated by working with these sort of like improvisational prompts that are deeply emotional and come from this place of wordlessness. And then eventually, once being in that flow state of like wordless creativity with sound, then allowing the word to come. And then the faster I kind of build that practice, or the more diligently I build that practice, then the wordless emotional practice can find the words kind of more quickly. Like right. the bridge in that experience can kind of like begin to flourish. And coming from quarantine and getting to have the time at Baryshnikov to deepen that again, was just beyond it was so much more than what I thought it would be, just for my own self as an artist, and being asked to make a video work, and even just being asked in general was so I was just really honored, because so many shredders have come through to do commissions for Baryshnikov. And I remember in 2017 or 2018, I was collaborating with Dorote Muneza. We were at Baryshnikov making our work Unwanted. And so it just kind of felt like this full circle moment to get to be there and work on this piece. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you how you, because you start this piece with play. And I wanted to ask you about play, because it feels like, you know, we, as the piece begins, we get to see you playing in a room, and we see you playing with your voice and with your hand and with the microphone and with this big yellow ball, which is like this thing that we, you know, it's like this thing that now gets in corporate culture or something, but we're like, no, this is a kid's situation here. Kids only.
Yes. So
I just wanted to ask you about like play and the role of play to get you into this piece and in your work in general, maybe.
Oh God, okay. Play is incredibly important for everybody. I think there was some point in growing up where playing like wasn't cool anymore. I remember there's a few different moments in my life where I remember there being this sort of like transition or pivot from being like, oh, I don't have access to that kind of freedom. There's like a door that has been closed. And I remember I really liked Barney as a kid, and there was like I was either in kindergarten or entering first grade where I was talking about how much I loved Barney, who, if people don't know who Barney is, he's this this kid show dinosaur, purple dinosaur guy in a big suit, I love you, you love me, just the sweetest, purest, most joyful, you know, being. And I was down for Barney. And I remember all of a sudden kids would be like, you like Barney? You can't like Barney. So that was one kind of point in my life where I felt like the door closed on play. And then another time, I remember I was maybe 12, I was in sixth grade, and I asked my sister's friends, who are a year older than me, if they wanted to play. And they were at a point in their growing up where you don't say play anymore, you say hanging out or kicking it. And this girl laughed at me. She was like, playing? Obviously things that like stuck to me because I'm 32 here talking about, right. You know, these moments. And, you know, with the pandemic and everything, I've had this really beautiful opportunity just to like go through all of my beliefs and identify which aren't mine anymore. What I want to keep. What doesn't make any sense for me to just kind of continue perpetuating my personal life and in my creative life. And, you know, and a part of that bringing in play was also just being able to do whatever I wanted to do from a place of like authentic joy and creating from there. That was a newer practice, especially emerging from this vortex of the unknown that we've just been fully riding for a year now. So play and just allowing myself to return to joy just because was not only just sort of like a personal practice, but then a creative practice as well.
Right.
Yeah.
That makes total sense. And it really comes through so profoundly. And I love that you're talking about the door to play, because it does feel like you walk through, that's the door to get into the piece. Is like, it almost feels like you're also, that's the door we need to walk through to receive the piece. It's like, okay, so there's going to be play here. So loosen up, you know what I mean? Like, and so you're kind of tuning, it almost feels like you use the door of play to kind of tune yourself and tune us to where we want to go.
Yeah, absolutely. I think, and the play also ties into this, I kind of larger concept of the work where, you know, what I repeat over and over again is when I want anything, I just want to feel better. And coming back to this place of play, it's kind of like building up this, kind of innate way that we can just allow ourselves to feel better without really anything else going on externally. Like kids, I don't know if any of y'all listening have kids. I don't. Or just you can just witness the creativity in the fantasy and just like a kid with a cup playing on the ground, a kid in some grass, a kid in some dirt. You know, they are masters at the craft of play, and there's no reason why we shouldn't be able to have that as well. So I really just for myself and to represent this in the music to see with all of the parameters of what I think I need to have in order to feel good, what if I can just with as little resource as possible, what do I want to just feel when I want to feel better? You know, when I want anything underneath what I want that thing to give me is like some deeper desire for a feeling of something, a feeling of wholeness. So I started doing these like meditations where I would just sit and feel whatever I wanted to feel, you know, just because, you know, if I wanted to feel like I was in love with in a loving relationship, I would just sit and meditate, just feeling romantic, full love, just because, you know, if I want to feel like I have all of my emotional needs met, if I don't have a real example of what that feels like, I can probably guess, you know, if it's something that I want, there's probably an idea of what it is like somewhere in my consciousness or somewhere that I can receive from somewhere outside of me and bring it into my awareness, into my self-awareness. So, you know, during a lot of lockdown time, I would just be in a place of fantasy, you know? And that was how I was able to become present, to become grounded, to become grateful for the things that I have. And, you know, it's not like I prescribed these two people to fix all of their problems. This was just my way through all of everything that was going on. And I was finding that I really liked the effect of it. Mm-hmm. And so when I kind of share these, when I have the opportunity to share these practices with people, I share them with the felt experience of the effectiveness of them. And what can be really fun too is now that I have this this practice of just like entering and creating kind of any emotional state that I want to, then I'm free. If I want to feel free and I have built this practice of just feeling free, then I can just enter the practice of feeling freedom, because your emotional reality is the foundation of all of our experiences for what's real, pretty much. Because if I'm sitting in my room and I feel like I'm free, even though I can't go inside, am I not really free? Why would it really matter that much if my felt sense in my body and in my heart is that I am, then that's all I really need. So that was kind of my anchor and my big lesson for the duration of the year. And I just got to share that in this work.
That discipline of feeling good and the discipline, the rigor with which you approach feeling good and pleasure transmits. And so thank you for the practice you've done, the rigor you've developed to be able to transmit that to us. And, you know, you're talking about fantasy and the worlds that kids make. And, you know, at one glance, you could see this piece is like, oh, this is a solo. This is one person in a room, maybe almost alone, performing for no audience. But then, like, sitting with this piece, particularly over the past few days, what's so clear is there's so much collaboration. There's so much collaboration in this piece. It's like collaboration between, obviously, you and Tatiana Tenenbaum, the filmmaker, and also between you and unseen forces, and also between the sun and the ball, the yellow ball, like between you and yourself, between the clarinet and the voice. There's a lot of collaboration, and even between us who received this work later than you recorded it. You know, so I just wonder if you can talk about the role of collaboration and how that informs or how you understand that in this piece.
Yeah, absolutely. You really hit the nail on the head with that, these pieces of collaboration. Absolutely. Kind of coming back to the idea of working within a set of kind of physical limitations in terms of resources. Not that, you know, Vershnikov wasn't providing me the resources that I needed. I'm just kind of more comfortable with like working with less and then making it as expansive as possible. A lot of my history in music came from experimental music and DIY music, and that being my kind of foundation in performance, really, because my path wasn't to come through college or university. It was to kind of find my own mastery in this sort of like underground world.
Right.
So these collaborators not really being maybe what one would expect in terms of like, oh yeah, I'm working with so-and-so and like we're meeting together and we're texting and emailing and writing and like singing and moving. And, you know, we had, it was just a different way that things were constructed, and kind of like entering this place of play where, you know, creating these different identities and then playing off of these different identities. And, you know, like this ball, which is like, the ball is my friend, the ball is my, you know, my baby blanket, the ball is the thing that like I'm protecting. It's something that I can show off with. I'm not really, if you haven't seen it yet, I'm not really doing a lot of showing off with the ball. and being in the Merce Cunningham studio, that light that's in that room, just like being its own, just giving me this like container of love. That in another way is related to this ball, where when I release the ball, it's the thing that I was kind of using to make me feel better, and then releasing it and then still finding the source of all this joy is still all around me with the sunlight, and the sun that will always endure even when I don't see it anymore and it's nighttime. And then I just get to play in the unknown during the nighttime. So I think you really hit the nail on the head. And just, and Tatiana's, how she was able to, just like really authentically capture that, that performance day. And it was really important for me to connect with the crew that were there, to just kind of get everybody feeling kind of vulnerable in a way. And I think I work really well too when I'm in these places of talking about healing through play and, you know, these like emotional prompts. I feel really good when I can bounce that off of each other and off of other people. So to be in a space with the crew that was there was incredibly generative to me, especially after just being alone in the space for the week, you know. So I think you really hit the nail on the head with that, for sure. Yeah.
The word bounce, like there's just so much bouncing happening, yeah, in the piece. And I hope everyone, it's online till March 29th. I hope you'll linger in this transmission. And the sun as a collaborator, like it just feels like you were in this deep collaboration with the sun, as the sun is setting over Manhattan. And there's obviously like you're exploring play to explore these deep spiritual questions, deep collective questions, and as a doorway in. And it feels like the sun as it's setting is like, and here we go again. You know, there's just this, mm-hmm, kind of this. So how was the sun to work with? What's the sun like on set? You know what I mean?
I mean, they're really cool. They're a lot nicer in person than language.
Oh, good. That's good. I haven't heard that. Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, I mean, like a lot of people think like, oh my God, they're like super cocky because they're like, oh my God, like I bring life to like everything or whatever. But like, they're like super like down to earth, like especially when they're setting. No, I mean, the sun really allowed me to feel held in beauty. And like, it allowed me to feel like I had this infinite access to the abundance of joy and bliss that I could ever want. That's how the sun made me feel in this moment, just this simple thing that is there every single day, that I get to be present and witness and just receive. I don't know. It's funny that you mentioned the sun, I don't really know if this is a space for that. I sometimes work with a spirituality integrated into my work very deeply. And the presence of Ra was with me in that space. He's this Egyptian sun god, or you know, whatever sort of like larger archetype of the sun was showing up as this archetype for me as Ra. So that's really neither here nor there, but maybe Ra just wanted to be mentioned because, you know how he can be just like, oh, talk about me, because like, you know, you evolve around me and stuff. But mm-hmm, it was really it allowed me just to find magic in the simplicity of just being in that space, really. Right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh yes, here, there, and everywhere. Thank
here,
you.
Here, there, and everywhere.
I wonder if you can share with us like about your process of sculpting a piece like this, of kind of creating the sonic, vocal, musical landscape, which we just kind of get enveloped in. And I encourage people to also listen to it multiple times because there's just so many, it expands. So could you just talk about your process of sculpting a piece like this?
Yeah. What was really cool was that I felt like I was relearning how to make something with all of this new me kind of feeling. there's a lot of parts of ourselves I think that we kind of left behind in early 2020 and 2019. So I was really trying to see like what is my version of making work now. So it usually, I mean, like on a practical level, it looks like me just kind of being in a space, recording everything that I'm doing, and just playing and doing my best to be compassionate to the voices that aren't being nice to me in the process of creation. And that having to like kind of reintegrate into that practice again was like a whole new thing. So I'm really embodied when I create. So it's a lot of improvisation, a lot of looping, a lot of listening to the same thing over and over again, listening to things back. And, you know, usually in some kind of, I don't know if you're this way with your work too. Somehow it's all just sort of this goop, and then it comes together. Yeah, I don't know how it comes together, but it comes together in this way that is just like maybe more beautiful than you thought it was gonna be. And I'm really lucky that like that's been my trajectory. You know, there's like all this uncertainty, and it's sort of, you know, there's this comparison a lot of people comparing their creative practice to sort of the evolution of a butterfly, where there's this caterpillar, but when they're in the cocoon, it's just mush. You just, a caterpillar becomes a bunch of mush. There's nothing in there. We talked about this one. We went to the beach one day. But it contains everything. It contains all of the parts in it. It has all the enzymes and the hormones to put the goop back into a butterfly, you know? So it almost seems kind of rapid, where I have all these parts that are just like, well, these are all here and they're good. How do I make them all make sense? And it's usually like the day before I need to get something in, where it just falls into place. Mm-hmm. The construct of time, when you're really feeling it, then it's like, oh, okay. Oh, it just becomes this like this emotional, invisible, multi-dimensional jigsaw puzzle that you somehow put together with the practice of your craft. So that's kind of how it worked for me. And I also want to share, so I released an EP in February, and I'm just going to put the link to it here in the chat box. And a lot of the material, there's a second song on the EP called Wordless, and it was inspired by the work that I created for Baryshnikov with Museum of Calm. So I'm just gonna put that there if people want to listen.
Purchase the album, support the artists, my friends.
Support the artists. It's funny, like I have whole days or parts of days where I fully forget that I'm an artist. Mm-hmm. And then because I'm just like, I'm kind of vibing. It's maybe not that helpful for people that I need to respond to for emails, but
that's a good auto reply. I'm vibing.
Listen.
I'm in the goop.
I'm astral projecting somewhere. I'm playing with Barney. Like, I just don't, I don't know where I, you know, just, I'll get back to you eventually.
Obal is with
Yeah. Eleanor can attest to this. How was it going to relate? There was a way that all going to make sense.
You spend whole days vibing about, you're talking about me.
Yeah.
How it connects to this time not being, I mean, we're so with you right now. Like it's.
Yeah. And when you're with me and I'm not with myself, then it's like, where is anybody?
fair enough.
But with creating this music, I think a part of what the vibing has to do is that whatever I'm doing, I'm just so incredibly present when I'm doing it. And the world that I created in the making of this work and in the making of the EP, it had all of my presence. And so having, and there's also this sort of like kind of transportation that I experience when I'm being creative, that when I'm not in a creative space, that it just feels sort of like they're just different planes of existence that I'm vibing upon. So I think I just wanted to just express that, like, that this work and this time that I got to have at Baryshnikov was just so much bigger than the week that I was there. It feels so much bigger than just this video. It's really opened and unlocked a lot within me. I feel like there was gratitude is what I am made of when I think of this work and the time that I got to spend.
I'm really glad you, I mean, it's every single word, and in particular that you brought in the EP, the word list, because these two bodies of work are overlapping, you know, Museum of Calm and this EP. And it feels like, and this is maybe like kind of moving us into my last question for us, which is about the audience and the listener. And, you know, you aren't performing, there are people in the room, right? There are people in the room that you were performing for, that you recorded this for. And also there is a deferral that we're in a different place in time when we're listening, but it's very much for us. And there is a feeling in your work inside of the goop of like, this is for you. This is for you. Not like, this is just goop, you know, like this is right. Me and my goop, but this is actually, there's a kind of hospitality or kindness or kind of like, there's a kind of like, this is, I want you to listen to this. This is for you. So I just wonder if you could talk about how you, what the role of the audience, the listener, the viewer is in your process, and kind of, yeah, how do we figure in?
Yeah, you hit the nail right on the head with that one too. The this is for you part comes from my own awareness of the healing journey that I've been on, and knowing that I'm not unique in the suffering that I experience and will experience in the future, and how that those experiences of pain can linger us and alter our thinking about who we are and what our value is. And a lot of that just comes from society and culture. And having gone through a very kind of rigorous healing journey, I try to distill as best as I can my version of how to offer that to other people, to kind of like democratize this idea of healing. Because healing doesn't only come from, you know, a person and their therapist. It's a holistic thing. So there's sort of like this, I always kind of feel like there's this practical element to my work as well. Healing kind of being the core of that. And it's when I'm performing, I mean, especially now when I can't be around people, I envision people being there that I'm singing to, saying, I know it hurts and I love you so much. I know it hurts and I love you so much. And I know how much that's worked for me, and it's no accident that that I get to share it with everybody else.
And we are so lucky, and thank you. Thank you for the conversation, for your work, friendship. I just feel really grateful that you are in this world. And that this piece
is. Thank you so much. This was such an honor. It's so good to see your face and to chat with you. And thanks everyone for being here on this Zoom call. If anybody has any questions, feel free to email me. Morgan, I love you so much. Thank you for being here and being present with me. And thank you, Baryshnikov, for this whole experience. And just full of joy and gratitude. Yeah.
Wow. Thanks for tuning
all
in.
All right. Thanks, everyone. Bye.